Welcome to Jazz Zone Together, our online jazz community where we will provide jazz education resources, interviews with jazz educators, artists, and celebrities, along with valuable tips and repertoire suggestions. Today, we're extremely honored to be joined by Grammy Award winning and world-renowned jazz trumpeter, Randy Brecker. As a recording artist, Randy has been included and featured on albums of superstar artists, as well as many albums of his own. His playing career continues as he just returned from performances in Europe and in the Middle East. Now, I'll be pleased to turn the mic over to Dick Dunscomb to conduct the interview with Randy. Dick, it's all yours.
Thank you, Bob. Oh, man. This is just the best that it could ever be. I just know that your career, I followed it from, I guess, basically the very beginning, and when we were both a little younger, but blood, sweat, and tears, and every step beyond. So welcome, Randy. It's so much a pleasure to have you here.
Well, of course, thanks for having me. I've watched the show many times.
Now, as we get into the interview, we'd like to start with the beginning. How did you get involved in music initially, and what led you to pursue music as your career path?
Well, I was literally born into it. My father was a semi-professional jazz pianist, singer, composer, had musicians over to the house all the time to jam sessions and had an extensive record collection. My mother was a visual artist, but she also played the piano. And I came from Philadelphia, which was and still is a hell of a jazz town, but particularly in the 50s, where Clifford Brown and Max Roach were ensconced. Train was on the scene. Dizzy Gillespie lived in Philly when he came up from the South and organized a lot of things. And there were hundreds and hundreds of musicians, particularly tenor players. So I was just born into it. And I tell this story all the time. When I was 2 weeks old, Dad wrote a tune for me. And the first line was, "I'll be so proud of you, Sonny, when I hear you give out on that horn." So my future was already set. He said that I would play drums, maybe a hot fife, and love music even more than my wife. I'm going to be the hottest man in town. So I was born into it. There wasn't any other path for me.
So you picked up the trumpet pretty early then, huh?
Yes, I was 8 years old, and once again, influenced by my dad and Clifford Brown being on the scene. Dad would go out and hear him all the time, and once he grabbed me when he was listening to one of Clifford's records, because I loved all the records too, from my earliest recollections. You know, he had such a beautiful sound. Dad kind of grabbed me by the collar, emotionally overcome, and said, "You know, Randy, trumpet's the greatest jazz instrument." So when I was 8 years old, sadly, we lived only one block out of the Philadelphia city limits. So officially we were in the suburbs, which didn't have the local school didn't have a great music program, but they did have trumpets or clarinets to study. So I grabbed the trumpet, of course, and started to study soon after. I was 8 years old with Sigmund Hering from the Philadelphia Orchestra. And I studied with him for about 5 or 6 years. Conversely, my brother didn't want to play the same instrument. He was 3 years younger. So as he put it, stuck with the clarinet, but he got a really good foundation for other woodwind instruments by studying with Leon Lester from the Philadelphia Orchestra. And to make a long story short, he switched to alto in ninth grade, and then he discovered Coltrane in the 10th grade, and the rest is history. But I was stuck with the trumpet from day one, 8 years old, and love the sound of it and still do. You know, I still love that. It's still my favorite instrument. Mm-hmm. So I'm prejudiced in that way.
Well, we love the sound that you produce, man. It's so beautiful. It's just beautiful. Now, I think you studied a little bit at Indiana University. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. But I also studied in Philly. He was a big influence with a guy who sadly passed away at a relatively young age. I think he was 52. His name was Tony Marcione. And he had a lot to do with the program at Massbaum Technical High School, where he taught people like Lee Morgan. He was Lee Morgan's primary teacher. And they had a great music program at that school. A lot of musicians out of Philadelphia went there or had some connection to it, including Train, who was on the scene quite a bit, Billy Root, Buddy DeFranco, a lot of musicians. But and so he was a big influence, along with a trumpet player more my age, with whom I took the lessons with Tony at his house, Evan Solot, for about, I suppose about 4 years. Evan founded the program eventually at the University of the Arts and has written arrangements for, you know, tons of people. But when I was 15, I went to the Stan Kenton Band Camp. This was in 1962 at Indiana University. Took a bus out there. It was a new school, new building, brand new round building. They had just gotten a bunch of $1 million endowments to hire great teachers from New York. The music school was very highly rated, and people like Jamie Abersold and David Baker and Jerry Coker, not quite on the scene full time yet, but they became known as the ABCs of jazz education. So I decided, because I liked the school so much and I had made some good contacts out there, to go to the school. And by then, David wasn't teaching there yet, but he was teaching in Indianapolis. So I'd drive in, take lessons, mostly studying Monk. Eventually, he asked me to join his band. So I actually did gigs around Indianapolis with David and a lot of the fine musicians that lived out there. And at the band camp, I met some young students that I was associated with for a very long time after that, people like Dave Sanborn. We were 15, Don Grolnick, Lou Marini, who I just saw a couple of days ago, all these years later. We became friends there and still are. So it was interesting. And the band camp was just fascinating. It was there I said, I'm doing this. This is it. This is it. I'm going to be a musician. Stan's whole band was there. Marvin Stam was my personal big band director, with whom I'm still friends with. In fact, I owe him a phone call this week. I'm going to give him a shout. And Cannibal Adderley Sextet was there one of the weeks, so I got to know all those gentlemen, and they all, in a way, all helped my career along, especially Joe Zawinul. Donald Byrd was there. So, man, you know, as a 15-year-old, I was set. And eventually I went there, let's see, what year was that? Late 1963, I entered the music program there. But I floated in and out of, I wasn't sure I wanted to be a teacher. I was in the education program. I was in liberal arts. I also had my eye on communications. I liked that, radio and television and journalism. I knew I could always perform as a jazz instrumentalist, but I wasn't sure about still, you know, the whole lifestyle, how much, you know, how to make a living, you know. So I was in and out of different things there. But we did have 1 year of particularly wonderful big band led by Jerry Coker. It was just first rate, and we won a bunch of contests, and we were sent on a State Department tour the next year, which was not the next year, but this was in 1965. We won the Notre Dame Jazz Festival. And in late January 1966, lo and behold, we went on a, when I even say this, I look back when I say, I can't believe I went away that long, 4 month, 16-week tour under the auspices of the United States State Department to the Middle East and Asia with a big band. And that was just beyond fascinating in that age, to see all that, hear all that different kinds of music, world music. and see that part of the world, which is, you know, hopefully not going up in flames as we speak. But I've been to all those countries, so I have a personal interest in the whole situation, obviously. And it was a fascinating trip. You know, I could spend the whole hour just on that, but I wanted to move ahead to the end of the tour. 16 weeks later, we were experienced soul brother tour, teenage road rats, let's put it like that. After 16 weeks, that's a long trip. But there was another contest in Vienna, Happenstance, right at the end of the tour. So several of us in the Indiana University Jazz Sextet improvisers went to the competition. It was the first international jazz competition. And the judges were Art Farmer, J.J. Johnson, Cannonball Adderley, who I already knew a little, Joe Zawinul, who I already knew a little, Ron Carter, and Mel Lewis. And the interesting thing was there were a lot of young musicians, obviously. We were there for about a week or 10 days in a youth hostel. And you probably know some of these names. Everyone unknown as yet. You know, we were all teenagers. Maybe I was a little older. I was maybe 19 going on 20. Miroslav Vitus was 17, still going to high school, I think. And George Mraz. This is where we all met. Jan Hammer, who was a little younger than all of us. Franco Ambrosetti, Eddie Daniels, Jigs Wiggum, Claudio Roditi, Joachim Kuhn. I'm leaving out a bunch of people, but this was instrumental in all of our career, just meeting each other, forming bands, getting to know the judges. And I decided to go to New York after that and finish my studies, although I never really finished at New York University. I took lessons with the great trumpeter Ray Crisara there. But from my contacts, I slowly got sucked into the studio scene, and Miroslav and Mraz and Jan came shortly after, so we were in a position to help ourselves. Clark Turry called me to join his big band. He had been a judge at the Notre Dame Jazz Festival. Mel eventually asked me to join Thad and Mel band about 3 months after we got in town. So one thing just really led to another. I had a pretty easy ride, I must say, going to New York at that period of time. There was a lot of studio work. Marvin Stammen moved to town, who had been my personal teacher at the band camp, and he got me into a lot of subbing for him when he couldn't do a gig. He was a little older. About 5 years older and had more experience. He got into the studio scene right away. And I got in via those guys, by Thad and Marvin and CT, Clark Turry, by playing in the bands. So I had a pretty easy time of it. The next time I blinked, I was working every day in the studios and in all those big bands. Duke Pearson had a big band. There were just every day there was somebody to play with. It's fascinating.
I am a little bit older than you. I remember those days as well. I was at that same camp, Randy, and went on to become a member of the Millikan University Jazz Band, which was in some of those festivals that you were mentioning well. And it was a golden age for big bands. It just seemed that, it was recognized, as you mentioned, by the State Department with tours and things like that. And boy, don't we wish that would happen again.
Yeah, it's such a shame that that they don't send groups out anymore. That aspect of the State Department is long gone. It was a lady named Irene Carstone, so I still remember her name. And I did a couple other State Department tours later with my own band to the communist Eastern Europe, and which fell about 6 months later. We went to all the satellite countries surrounding Russia. This, I forget what year it was. Well, I think it was 1989. And about 6 weeks later, after we left, the whole thing collapsed. So that's been a big part of my bio, I suppose, was working for the State Department. I did a couple other short ones for them, too, for her.
Now, you've always been an innovator, and I think that began a long time ago. As the music was becoming a little more contemporary, a little bit more funky, a little bit more edgy. Talk about that transitional period there.
Well, you're right. By the time I had gotten to even by high school, later years in high school, but especially to college, you know, things had shifted. The Beatles and the Rolling Stones and the British Invasion and the and rock and roll, or whatever you want to call it, became more sophisticated, mostly due to the Beatles and George Martin. But it also, my ubiquitousness, if that's a word, really began in Philly, which was a potpourri of different styles of music people wanted to work. So I wasn't just doing jazz gigs when I started working around Philly. I was doing a lot of R&B gigs where you had to make up your part. Remember, I was in a kind of Count Basie-ish kind of band, small big band, where you had to pretty much make up your parts. And the singer was a guy named Mr. Blues, and he was a cop. And it was like playing with Count Basie's band. There was some really good players in that where you had to make up your own part. And so I was doing a lot of R&B, soul music stuff in Philly. And there was the Philadelphia Orchestra, but there was a lot of jazz, and there was I was just exposed to a lot of different styles of music because it was such a well-versed jazz town. And by the time I got to college, the Beatles were heavily ensconced, and most of us liked other styles of music. I just took to it. I loved the Beatles and the Stones. I liked the sounds. Like the chords they used, and I just love music, man. I mean, that's what it boiled down to, country music. I still love, for different reasons, I love the stories, writing words. I was always kind of, as a hobby, writing lyrics, too. So I just, what can I say? I enjoyed being what was known as a freelance musician, and I first heard that word one summer. I went out to Seattle to chase after my first girlfriend who couldn't come back to IU. And that was also an amazing, ended up, my parents let me go if I would take some college courses, which I did during the day at the University of Washington, writing courses. Because like I said, I was into communication too. I was pretty good writer. So I took some English writing courses, and that part was also fascinating. But Seattle was also an amazing jazz town. That's where I met Larry Coryell, who had a steady gig at the Embers. And I played there two or three nights a week with him, and that led to a lifelong relationship. There was also a club called the Penthouse. And 1 week, Horace Silver was there with Woody Shaw on trumpet. We were the same age, 19 years old. We hadn't even turned 20 yet, although he was 6 months older than I was. Joe Henderson was in that band, and I got really friendly with Woody that week. There were jam sessions at the club during the day, so he heard me play. We'd play before they'd go on, and he was also very helpful when I moved to New York, getting me gigs and stuff that he couldn't do, and he was playing in a lot of the big bands, too. But that was also a very influential summer. The next week, for instance, and Woody was the first guy who said, you know, after this, I'm eventually going to leave Horace and become a freelance musician in New York. And that freelance word stuck in my head. I said, you know, that's really what I want to do. I want to try to stay in New York and work. And Woody spent a lot of years just doing that, but was more of a band leader. That was came natural to him. The next week was actually Art Blakey. I was beside myself. I got to finally meet my Philadelphia idol, Lee Morgan, and we palled around that week. And he was also very helpful when I moved to New York. So that was also a big part. And there's a lot of other musicians that I met in out that particular summer that eventually moved to New York, and we once again helped each other. Seattle's still a pretty amazing jazz town or music town, although grunge has taken over out there, I think, but it's a fascinating place. So thusly, I moved to New York in 1963. And by the time I was through college, I was working pretty regularly with all those big bands, and everybody had a big band. It wasn't kind of nationally, I think big bands were kind of on fading in the public's consciousness, because most of these bands weren't touring, but they were all great big bands. Thad and Mel's, Clark Terry's, Duke Pearson's, I guess they were the big three that worked the most. Joe Henderson had a big band. Chuck Israels had a big band, and there were a lot of big rehearsal bands that all just rehearsed. So it was kind of every day, if you didn't have a gig, somebody would call me to go to Lynn Oliver's studio and rehearse with, and they were all good. And there were also some jazz rock big bands, because that was melding. There was a guy named George Andrews. He probably had one of the first jazz rock big bands. I played in that, which is where I met some rock musicians, and it led to me being called by Blood, Sweat, and Tears. In fact, I had done some kind of rehearsal at Juilliard with their jazz ensemble, and the other trumpet player, Jerry Weiss, had already been asked to join Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and he's the one that got me on the gig when the trumpet player they had was a high school band director, and he decided he didn't want to leave town and leave his gig. So I stayed with that band for about just under a year and recorded the first record with them, and then Horace called along the way. And I was also playing with Thad and Mel. I was doing a lot of different things, freelancing in New York, playing with Joe Baton, and it was just a lot going on. I can't even remember, it's just kind of a jangle in my head. There was so much going on. Every day we worked. Remember, we're running from session to session with Marvin, because you'd have a 10 to 1, and then you'd have a 1:30, so you had to get from one studio to another. Literally running, because a lot of the studios were near each other in Midtown.
Randy, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Well, the thing that I was going to mention is that we really must talk about the Brecker brothers and how that came about, and give us some insights on that.
Well, let me think. Let's talk about a band called that we didn't talk about yet, because that's what really led into the Brecker brothers by a set of circuitous circumstances. I played with Horace Silver for close to 2 years, between a year and a half and 2 years. In the interim, Mike had moved to New York and met a trombone player by the name of Barry Rogers, who was very famous in the Latin music scene. And they became close. They were doing some gigs together. Barry had met a couple singer-songwriters named Jeff Kent, Doug Lubon, who wanted to start a band called Dreams. Sadly, they're no longer with us. And at the same time, Billy Cobham and I, who were on the road with Horace — Billy was the drummer with Horace, along with Benny Maupin, the great saxophonist, and John B. Williams — one day Horace had a meeting and said, guys, I'm moving to California, so I need to break up the band. So this is your 2 weeks' notice. He was very businesslike in everything. So he gave us partial 2 weeks' pay, and we trudged back to New York, Billy and I. I think Benny was moving to California then too, where he still is. And we ran into Mike one night, who explained this whole story, how he had met this trombone player, Barry Rogers, and the two singer-songwriters, and they were looking for a trumpet player and a drummer. And he wasn't seriously thinking about us, but we were just fired from Horace. So, hey, we're back in town. You know, we're available. And thus became the band Dreams. Myself, Billy Cobham, Barry Rogers was the horn section, great horn section. Billy Cobham, Jeff Kent, Doug Lubon. And what was unusual about this band, we didn't write arrangements. The three of us, the horn players, we were great at jamming up everything. And this is when cassettes first came out. Mm-hmm. So we could tape all the rehearsals. And we eventually got signed to Columbia Records and did two moderately successful albums. And what that did is solidify our people thought of us as a horn section. So we started to really get a lot of work in the studios. A lot of contractors came down. Eventually, the great bass player Will Lee joined the band, and the great pianist that I had known since I was 15, Don Grolnick, joined the band. And we added John Abercrombie on guitar and another lead singer, Eddie Vernon. And we became the house band at the Village Gate. We played there pretty much every weekend or every week for months on end. And that really solidified our careers in New York because so many people heard us play. And that's really what led me to start thinking maybe I should try to write my own tunes because I can always do studio work, but there should be a spot for me somewhere. I remember listening to Herbie Hancock interview and this had a big influence on me. The interviewer asked, "So Herbie, what's your main influence for writing tunes?" And Herbie said, "Well, you know, my main influence is if it's Tuesday and I have a record to do on Thursday and I don't have any material, then I have to write some music." And I took that to mind, said maybe I should really go after my own writing and try to go after a record contract where I'm kind of forced to have a schedule and write and really find where my own voice is. So I started slowly doing that. And in the interim, let me think of this. John McLaughlin came to New York, actually stayed at my apartment for a while through another set of circuitous circumstances. But eventually he started a band called the Mahavishnu Orchestra, and he stole Billy from Dreams. And we couldn't find another drummer. So in the interim, we broke up. We auditioned like 60 drummers, but nobody played like that yet. McLaughlin knew what he was doing. So Mike and I rejoined Horace with Will Lee for several months. And that was really a period where I really started thinking about writing and got an electric piano at my loft and a clavinet. I was also somehow in there. I played with Stevie Wonder for about 9 months too in there somewhere because his regular trumpet player had fractured his skull. And Sanborn was the other horn player, my old buddy. He got me on that gig. And of course, that was a big influence. And I said, look, this guy writes, you know, I could tell he worked on his music 24 hours a day. So whenever I was home, I'd start sitting at the piano with pencil and paper and a tape recorder on. And I started to write music for myself, really. And I had in mind the horn section being Sanborn, myself, and my brother for this one. And Grolnick and Will Lee and Chris Parker, we ended up rehearsing a lot of stuff, trying to get the scenario right. At this point, Billy had become really famous. So me and Mike were playing with Billy Cobham's band. Mahavishnu didn't last that long, but Billy's first record really went up the charts. And all during that time, I was home writing stuff like some Skunk Funk. In fact, the first version of some Skunk Funk was recorded by Billy. I forgot that until I saw the old score. It was written for trombone. And I wrote some other stuff that we played with Billy that really ended up on the Brecker Brothers record. Eventually, I had 9 charts written, and I was just about to get to start really doing a demo, which is what you had to do, go into a recording studio, record your music, and then try to sell it, take it around, hire somebody to take around to the record companies. But we already had had this connection with Clive Davis, the wonderful, famous Clive Davis, who had at the time been fired by Columbia Records. There was some kind of scandal that he was proven innocent of, and he was innocent. He wasn't doing anything that everyone else wasn't doing as far as, they coined the word payola, but it was always in there somewhere. Either people would buy ads. Anyway, he was proven innocent, and he didn't do jail time. It was innocent. But he started a new record label called Arista, and he had hired as an executive producer a guy named Steve Backer. So just during this period when I was saying, well, I'm going to do a demo now, I got a call from Steve Backer. It's just kind of interesting because he asked how the Brecker brothers started. He said, Mr. Brecker, my name's Steve Backer. I just signed a production deal with Clive Davis. And he's interested. He's heard about this music you've been writing. It was a smaller world. Somehow it got it. We rehearsed every week, and I guess people talked. A couple people heard the rehearsals, and it somehow got back to Clive that we were together. He knew all of us. And Steve said, you know, Clive wants to sign you. You won't have to do a demo. You won't have to try it. We'll sign you. And I said, well, that's great. He said, oh, there's only one caveat. You have to call this band the Brecker Brothers. So you asked, they named the band. Because I had written all the music. I was going after a solo project. You know, I wanted to be Randy Brecker because I was in the studios. That was the whole idea. And I had never even thought, you know, no one had called us the Brecker. He actually really thought of the name. Mm-hmm. I remember there was one review with Billy Cobham where they called us the Brothers Brecker. But it never occurred to me. So Clive, in his ultimate genius, thought of the name. And at first I protested because I wanted to, you know, I had spent a lot of time, year and a half, on this, writing all this music. But they insisted, and I thought about it for a week. I tried telling them that Sanborn was going to be in the front line. It would look funny. Was he going to be the long-lost cousin? Because it's three of us in the front line. But it was too good of an opportunity. So I said, okay, call it the Brecker Brothers. And that's how the thing started. The next thing we knew, we went in the studio for Clive, Steve Backer at the helm, and we really knew what we were doing by then because we were experienced studio cats. And we churned out the tunes. We knew them really well. But that wasn't really the end of the story, and I've told this story many times too. The stuff came out great. You know, we had Harvey Mason actually on drums and Chris Parker also. And Ralph McDonald, the great Ralph McDonald, late great Ralph McDonald on percussion. Everything came out perfect. You know, we really knew what we were doing. Steve Backer was nonplussed. He was shocked because he was used to working with jazz musicians who showed up to the studio and then one looked at the other and say, okay, now what are we going to play? You know, he was used to those kind of records. We had everything planned. We knew how to build the thing from the bottom up, what to overdub, what to track, how to double track the horns, all the little studio. We just knew how to do it. But that wasn't the end of the story because Clive called me up to his office and said, look, everything you recorded was great, but you don't have a single. You need a single. And I kind of hit the ceiling because I said, look, first of all, you're calling it the Brecker Brothers. When it was supposed to be my solo record, that's what I was going after. I acquiesced for that one, but I wanted it to be all stuff that I had written, and we recorded everything. He said, well, in his diplomatic way, if you don't do a single, this record ain't coming out. So he held the gun to my head. I trudged back to the rehearsal studio, and I still have this cassette. We jammed up a tune. We were really good at that. That was one of the went back to the Dreams days where we could just jam stuff up on the top of our head. Somebody would come up with an idea. We'd get a groove going. Everybody contributed a little something. And then in about 4 hours, we had a tune called Sneaking Up Behind You. We went in a couple days later, recorded it, and Clive was at the session. He just wanted to oversee the whole thing. And he made a couple little suggestions, which we took, and he added it to the record. So now there were 10 tunes, put it out as a single, and the next thing we know, it's number two on the the urban chart, which was really high up there. That was the black charts that were like R&B, what they called it, urban music. So the next thing we know, we're starting to get gigs, festival gigs with Parliament Funkadelic, Chaka Khan. Everybody thinks we're black too, the Brecker Brothers. People will come backstage, where are the Brecker Brothers? Where are the Brecker Brothers? Where are the Brecker Brothers? And we go, hey, we're the Brecker Brothers. but it was really due to that single, Sneaking Up Behind You, selling so well that sold the record. And eventually, like the other tunes, like some Skunk Funk, the more really Randy tunes, worked their way into musicians' consciousness to where, particularly that tune became kind of a rite of passage for young musicians to have to play. So now on YouTube, there's like 40,000 versions of some Skunk Funk with different bands playing. And in fact, a friend of mine, who's a Michael Brecker archivist, Louis Juritz, I don't know how long this took. He has a version of some Skunk Funk by everyone on YouTube, it's called. And every bar is a different band playing. Every once in a while, we pop in there. We play the first bar. But literally every bar, 1, 2, 3, 4, new band, 1, 2, 3, 4, new band, 1, 2, 3, 4. Throughout the whole thing, I've never counted how many people played, including Michael's solo, transcribed every bar as a different person playing a solo. So it was very gratifying to see that people liked the music and kind of went to concerts. And eventually we just went out on our own, Brecker Brothers, although we kept the studio work up too, as much as we could. Clive could never get us out on the road full time. You know, that was always the next big argument, because we were working too much in the studios, writing and playing. But we did tour a lot in Europe, and we eventually toured a decent amount. He got us out there half the time. So that's the story.
I just have to take a deep breath, Randy. Yeah. I'm, as I said at the very beginning, I've loved your playing from the very beginning. But through this interview, you're an encyclopedia of jazz music and the progression that it's made through these years. The people that observe these things that we put together, like today's, are often made up of band directors. And they have their own jazz bands in their schools, which, as you know, pretty prolific these days. So sure. I have to ask you, talk to them a little bit about what they need to do with those kids. And if they have one that's really interested in becoming a Randy Brecker, what would you recommend?
Well, that's kind of a tough question to answer these days, because technology technology, that's the main word, and now AI, who knows where that's going to go. But for me, it was the fact that I got my name out there and this hasn't changed that much. There's still a lot of college and high school competitions that exists, and quite often they're not competitive. They don't give out, you know, number one band, number two band. Although I tend to agree that that was a good impetus, because it was competitive to get us off our butts, so to speak, and try to be as good as possible. So number one, I would say, try to go take your band. My 15-year-old is in her high school band, and they travel to different contests and play with other big bands. She plays tenor in Barry in the jazz band. They're working on a Joe Henderson tune now. So that's number one. But I think writing these days is a very important part of the deal. You know, not only be a player, but the players that seem to be successful, and that goes all the way back to the beginning, were also composers. That goes back to Louis Armstrong, you know, John Coltrane. All the greats were also wonderful composers that played their own music. Horace Silver, obviously, he was such a big influence. So I caught on with that. Was another reason why I wanted to write my own music, because that was the way to, well, you just did that. If you wanted to be a full-time musician, you wanted to play your own vocabulary. So that's number two. And also these days teach. A lot of great musicians have full-time teaching jobs, and jazz is alive and well on that level. I do a lot of workshops. I don't really have time to teach one-on-one, and although I tried for a week, for a semester at Manhattan School of Music, but I was just away too much to really keep up with the lessons. It wasn't fair. But I do a lot of workshops, master classes all over the world now. Now that jazz has become global, even in China, there's hundreds of jazz schools where 20 years ago there weren't any. Kind of fascinating in its own right. So you can go anywhere and find jazz school and people teaching jazz and spawning out really wonderful young musicians. And but young musicians these days have to kind of fend for themselves too, you know, go on social websites and make their, you have to be your own PR person. It's also, if you have money, you can hire one, but it's better if you just have to get your name and your music out there. So, you know, film your rehearsals, put them up on YouTube or on all the various sites, and just get your name out there as much as possible. That would kind of be it in a nutshell. And I'm not one to disagree with jazz education. There's a lot of always talk about maybe they're not teaching the right things or blah, 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 but I think they're doing a great job. There's a lot of great, amazing young musicians daily coming out that do things I couldn't imagine doing at their age.
Amen. That's really good information. And so let's look forward a little bit. What's on your horizon in the coming weeks, days, months?
Next week we're taking the Brecker Brothers band reunion. We haven't done that for about 5 years now with pandemic, back to Japan. So it'll be nice with a lot of the same guys that played in the band, Will Lee, George Whitty, Barry Finnerty, who was on Heavy Metal Bebop, and Rodney Holmes, who was on our later 90s records. Luckily, and I'm blessed to have my wife, Ada Rovati, who's a wonderful saxophonist in her own right and composer. And she has always been taking over. That's a hard job, to take over my brother's spot in the band. But she has her own way of playing, and I'm very proud of her. So that's the next week we're going. And we're also just starting to promote a record under her name that I kind of helped in the background. It's called The Secret World of Pilou, which is her nickname, from Italy. And she wrote 10 tunes. Four with lyrics and great singers. So we're just figuring out how to put this together with our own PR and how to sell it these days, because she's more up on it than me. That's a question I couldn't really answer, because things are moving so fast in the electronic, once again, that world. It's a matter of getting on playlists, stuff I barely know anything about, but she's more well-versed in that. So that's on the immediate agenda. I've had a lot of projects out the last few years, so I'm kind of taking a little break from my own projects till I figure out what I might want to do. And what I might want to do is just do a real jazz quartet record. That's looming around in my head, but I have to give it more thought, because that's the one thing I'm a little short on. I've done a lot of large ensemble. The most recent one is from Brazil, which was recorded in Manaus with a wonderful Brazilian big band. doing my music. So that's just came out. We just voted for it on the Grammy list. There'll be other projects, but I'm taking my time this time, mostly because I want to help with her record. My daughter has a record out. She's a singer, songwriter. That happens to be out now. They're just putting it up on Facebook, their second tune. So there's a lot of music happening at the same time in the family.
And it goes on and on and on.
Yeah, it'll go on. You know, I'll be doing this until I'm ready to drop, which sadly hasn't happened yet.
No, that's not in the picture, my friend. Yeah. You know, it's very interesting because as I think back over the discussions that we've had today, "Where in the World is Randy Brecker?" would be a great title for a synopsis of a book by you. It's just that you've been everywhere. You've met everybody. You are the man. And Randy, thank you so much for this interview. I loved it.
Well, thank you for having me. Good questions. And I was in a talkative mood, so you got me on a good day.
Great.
Oh, it's great to talk. Well, thanks for having me, guys. This was really a lot of fun. And now I think I'll take a little break and have lunch.
All right.
Randy,
okay,
I'll echo Dick's thank yous there. And to our viewers, thanks for watching. We hope you found the interview of real value. Please check out our entire library of video interviews for more valuable content. Watch our website for updates as we're adding new interviews regularly.